I had a good day yesterday. Praise the Lord. Saturday was a good day. We had 22 young people come to TNT on Saturday. Thank you for those that put some extra effort in getting the kids to the pickup points. And even yesterday, just Abraham was able to challenge the guys. They listened well. They really did. And don't miss out. There's a lot of stuff going on. You say, well, I just do my one ministry. Don't miss out. There's a lot of stuff going on that you could jump into. Don't miss out. And that's a good thing to just try to plug yourself into things that are extras. Use that, you that aren't on a bus route. Maybe one day just slip over and encourage one of these boys or girls and say, I'll pray for you. There's nothing wrong with that. You say, I'm not assigned to that. There's a lot of things going on that we don't have to be assigned to. And so let me encourage you. Hopefully, whenever you leave here and go to a ministry, you're not saying, well, I'm just a youth pastor. That's all I do. Well, you haven't been trained properly. You don't have the right spirit of service. And so my challenge is, there's kids walking all over campus on Sundays, and some of you that aren't on bus, sit with them on Sunday morning. It really would help the cause of some of the problems. We might not have the cops called as often. But it could be good if 10 of you said, you know, I'll sit with two. That takes away 20 potential problems. Just a thought. And the Lord's really stirred up a burden in my heart. I walk through Chesterton High School and see a couple thousand kids there with really no direction. And I'm limited, obviously, but we got to do something. There's kids through here that you could just be a blessing to. You can encourage them. Take advantage of that. I like to be encouraged by people. So let's flip it around, and they might like to be encouraged by you. You say, well, they're bad. They're going to sleep in church. The guys I had yesterday, they played ball from 2 to 4. They slept through almost the entire service yesterday. Some of you did, too. Elio, we won't mention your names, though. But they slept through the entire service. But my thought was, at the end of the day, at least they were at church. They could have been home watching who knows what or on some stupid site. They're at least in church. And so take that time. Pray for them. Give them a little encouragement. And you know, I was tired last night, but it was a good tired. And when you serve the Lord, I know how it is, bus routes, things like that, these cold mornings, it's a good thing. And when you start to serve, it really is a joy. So just, I want to challenge you kind of with a little bit of an odd message today. This is kind of, I would say, my testimony for the last, 6 months to a year. So it's pretty personal to me. And the whole point of it is going to be at the end. So I hope I get there. That's my desire, is that I can get there. But let's look at Luke 22 in just a moment. We'll pray and then ask the Lord just to help us. And then we'll get into this text. Lord, it's my desire today to be transparent with these young men and young ladies who've assembled together. I know it's not necessarily their choice to be here, but they're here. And I pray that as we open up your word, that it would be exactly that, your word, to challenge us. And if necessary today, to change us. I pray that you would speak to my heart as you have. And I pray that I could get this across to the youngest, from the youngest to the oldest, to even us as a staff today, that we could leave here knowing that you met with us and you spoke to us. Thank you for the Lord's Day we could celebrate yesterday and the things we could do to try to encourage and help those that come in. Thank you for those that trusted Christ as Savior. Thank you for those who were baptized last night. Lord, we should be thrilled when you're working, and you are. We don't want to miss out on that. So I pray that you'd use this text today to encourage us. I ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. One of my favorite things to do in ministry is to try to encourage people. I look for people on Sunday mornings that are sitting by themselves, and I make it a point to go and say hello to them. I try to see everybody in the auditorium before Sunday morning. Sometimes you'll go up to somebody and they're sitting there all by themselves, and they'll say, I'll say, hey, who invited you? And like, I just showed up. But I like to try to go and encourage them. I like to go, when I go to Chesterton High School, I like to find the kids that are there, they're sitting at the table by themselves. Those are the ones I like to go talk to. I like to be the person that goes up to somebody and say, hey, put my arm around them, say, hey, can I help you? Is there something? I enjoy that. Now, it's pretty easy to be an encourager when all is going well. But I want to flip the script today, and really at the end of the message, we're going to completely change that mindset. Even guys, when we're in the gym, Stephen, he said I wouldn't call him out. when you're down, I like to try to lift you up. You may not feel that way. But I like to say, come on, let's go, let's go, let's go. There's something joyful in being an encourager. But it really is pretty easy when my life is on cloud nine, if I can say it that way, and things are going well in my life. I'm going to title this message, You Might Need a New Conversion. You'll follow this in just a little bit. I love Luke 22. I think I've preached more messages out of Luke 22 than any other message or any other text. And actually, I went back. I was going to preach on this text, and I found a sermon from 2005. I thought, well, they won't remember what I preached in 2018, let alone what I preached 14 years ago. And so I was reviewing some things, and Thursday, as I was kind of just praying about it, the Lord took the same text and said, I want you to preach something different. I want you to preach your testimony a little bit. And so I really enjoyed this. It might be a little jumbled for you, but for me it makes sense. So hopefully it does. And like I said, at the end is where we're going to get kind of the thrust of where the Lord's corrected me in some areas. Luke 22, verses 31 to 34. Let's go ahead and stand, and this will help keep you awake. Let's go ahead and stand. We'll read verses 31 down to verse number 34. Are you there? Together. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. And he said unto him, Lord, I am ready to go with thee, both into prison and to death. And he said, I tell thee, Peter, the cock shall not crow this day before that thou shalt thrice deny that thou knowest me. You can have a seat. If we were going to script this particular passage out, Luke chapter 22, and put it in play format, we'd find three main characters. And I like alliteration, and the alliteration is already given to us. We have Satan, we have the Savior, and we have the fisherman turned disciple of Christ. His name is Simon. I don't think we need to say a whole lot about any of these three because most of us could give us a discourse probably in all three of these particular characters. So we're going to get right into it. Number one, I'd like to call this person in the script Satan, but I'd like to call him the sifter. The sifter. Jesus says to Simon this, Simon, Satan hath desired to have you. May I remind you this morning, Satan is the prince of evil. One of his works is to try the works of believers. And he does it in such a way where he puts you to the test, if I can say it that way. God allowed Job into the very hands of this deceiver. He allowed him to be tested. He allowed him to be tempted. And may I say this, he's going to do the same to you. He's going to allow this testing to come into play, if you will. And the whole purpose of this sifting process is to see if he's going to be able to find you faithful or to be one that falls away. So he does this to Job. He also does this now to Peter. What he says is he wants to sift you as wheat. Now, I don't know the whole agricultural thing, but I understand this. The purpose of sifting was to take the grain of wheat and to, if I can say it this way, to agitate it. It was to be shaken in such a way as to cause a form of separation. The grain would remain in this particular fan, if I could say it that way, and the chaff and the dust was kind of separated to where it was worthless. And the fan or the wind, if they did it in an upper area in land on a plain of some sort, the wind would take it and drive it away, as we know that passage in the scriptures as well. So Christ says, Satan desires to have you that he may sift you. He's going to put a trial and temptation before you to see if there's any faithfulness that remains in you. Peter was to be sifted, and he was therefore warned. I'd like to challenge you with a warning today. The devil wants to sift you as wheat. We must be serious about this. The devil is not your friend. He is the wicked one. He is the devourer. He is the great dragon. He is the serpent. He wants to take your life, and can I say it this way? Agitate you, annoy you, and see if your faith is real. It would be a great satisfaction to him to have a believer in his control. He was anxious to get one of Jesus' very own followers. if Satan knows this, he can't quite destroy a believer, but he knows this. He wants to defile them. If he cannot devour you, he wants to defile you. If he cannot ruin you, he wants to agitate your life to take away your peace and your joy and the comfort that God wants to give you. Now here's the problem. Why would God allow this? Wouldn't it be nice if the devil had no power at all to agitate your life? It would be really nice if I can get up in the morning and my kids would come out with a halo on their heads for family devotions. Yeah, Dad, we just read through Ezekiel this morning. Let us talk about the wheel in the middle of the wheel. I would like if it would be said that our marriage was perfect. I would like it to be said that in the ministries we served, there were no problems. I would like it to be said that the devil wasn't there trying to sift our lives and cause an agitation, but can I say this? Even as you study in for ministry, even as you serve in our ministries, the devil's there trying to bring tests and temptations in your life to separate some things. Why does God allow this? Sifting, though, in one sense, we have to look at God and say it brings a desirable result because it does bring a separation. It does show what we really are. The devil wishes that the good would fall to the ground and it be trampled, but God overrules it to separate it for his purposes, to purify it, to put it into his granaries, if I can say it that way. God finds a good reason for allowing his saints to be tempted. It may be that you're tempted for the good of somebody else. We've heard of the patience of Job, haven't we? But we would never know the patience of Job if he had not been sifted. So what I'm saying is this sifting process is for our benefit. It's a good thing. Don't be afraid of the tests that come. So we see the sifter, Satan. Number two, though, I like this. The Savior, I call him the supplicator. Before the devil's desire to have Simon, and before this sifting process begins, Christ makes it clear. What does he say? I have prayed for thee. Man, I'll tell you what, I got stirred when I was just thinking about this. When I'm going through difficulties, when the devil's testing me and putting temptations, I have the same promise that Simon had. Jesus says, I have prayed for thee. It's a personal prayer. Just this morning, I got a text come across from one of my pastor friends. He says, Brother Ramos, praying for you and your family. I love that. I love when people pray for us. I love when people pray for our family. I love when people pray for our church. I love when people pray for our college and our youth group. I love when people come and say, we're praying for TNT. I love when people come and say, they say we're praying for when you need to travel. I love that. I love it even more when I see people pray for me who I know their prayers get answered. That's even more encouragement. Like, pray for me more because I've seen the blessings along the way. But how much more thrilling than that is to know the Savior prays for you. Wow. You're going to go through tests, guys. Young ladies, you're going to go through tests. But can I encourage you in this supplicator? There's an encouragement. I have prayed for. He doesn't say pray for yourself in the test, which we should, and that's a good thing. He doesn't say thy brethren have prayed for thee. He says I have prayed for thee. Man, what a joy to know, a comfort to know that when you pass through the deep waters, Jesus has already been there. You may be comforted by prayers of a parent. Praise the Lord for that. You may be comforted by a prayer of a pastor, some Christian man in your church, some lady that comes and is there for you. They intercede for you. We should be grateful for that. That's a wonderful thing. I'd love to have Paul praying for me. Man, you read the letters of Paul. I'm praying for you and grace and mercy and peace with you. Noah and Samuel, these men. But above all else, we can say Jesus is praying for us. That's the encouragement in this prayer of the supplicator. But I'd like to focus, though. What does his prayer say? When Jesus prays, what does he say? Look down there. He says, I have prayed for thee. And what's the prayer? What's the focus of his prayer? Stay with me, Lawrence. What's the focus of his prayer? Help me out. That thy faith fail not. As long as our faith is safe, our self is safe, if I can say it that way. Faith is the standard bearer. Faith is the banner that goes before us and says, here we are in our life. It's focused on our faith. If our faith fails, everything else is going to fail. Our courage is going to fail. Our joy is going to fail. Our hope, our love, it's going to fail if our faith fails. The faith here is our key. So that's why Jesus says, I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. Jesus says it this way, when the Son of Man cometh, will he find, help me out, faith. Without what? It is impossible to please him. Without faith, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Jesus says to a certain lady, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. To many, Jesus said, thy faith hath made thee whole. To the disciples, when he calmed the storm, he said, O ye of little, help me out, faith. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. For by grace are you saved through faith. Above all, taking the shield of faith. The grain of mustard seed is likened an illustration of faith. Hebrews 11, we heard about it Sunday morning and Sunday night. By faith, if our faith falters, everything else goes. So Jesus, when he prays for us, doesn't pray for us to have comfort and peace and love and joy. He prays for our faith. That's the focus of Jesus' prayer. But here's the challenge in Jesus' prayer, and this is kind of like what I like to talk about as far as my testimony is concerned. He says, I'm praying for your faith, that your faith fail not. And then here's the second part of his prayer, or second part of his statement to Peter. He says, when thou art, look down there, when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. That phrase has kind of gripped my heart. It's almost as Jesus tells Peter, you're coming to a point where you're going to need conversion, because he says, when thou art converted. He doesn't say if you're converted, because Jesus knows what's coming. Peter thinks he's got it all figured out, but Jesus is telling him, hey, when you are converted, here's what I want you to do. So stay with me. It's almost as if Jesus is saying this, when you come back to where you're supposed to be, your old faith and your old life and your old joy and your old happiness, what I want you to do when you become converted, I want you to strengthen your brethren. Now, when I think of a convert, I think of someone getting saved. We hear that, right? We say they are a new convert or a new creature, right? That's the idea. They have turned from their old life, yes, to a new life. You remember that day. Jesse, where's Jesse at? What an exciting day. What, just a little over a week ago. Praise the Lord. Where's Miss Kriegel? Didn't even tell me. I had to find out when she was in the Baptist. I was upset with her. But you know what? That's exciting to know I was this. And now I'm this. That's conversion. I used to hate math when we have to take these English measurements and convert them to the metric. And to this day, I'm still confused about it. And I go down to Mexico, and it's like, all right, gas is not in gallons, it's in liters and so forth. And I just forget it. I can't figure it out. And there's something about conversion. It's a substance, but it changes to something else. We understand that when it comes to salvation, because that in its truest form is conversion. But I don't think Jesus is talking to Peter about salvation here. He's talking about another conversion. He's talking about another change, going from one point to something else. It seems that he's preparing him for another form of conversion. So he says this, Simon, when you are converted, here's the words of what conversion means. To revert, to come back again, to turn about. What he's saying is, Peter, you're going this way. You're going to come to a point where you stop, when you turn about, when you revert back to what you were, then this is what you're supposed to do. So don't just turn around and stop. He's giving them a challenge to say, when you turn about, when you revert, strengthen your brethren. This is what he's telling them to do. He's saying to set fast your brethren, to turn resolutely in a direction your brethren, to confirm your brethren, to fix your brethren, to establish your brethren, to steadfastly set the brethren. So you have a purpose when you get right with God, not to just stand there and do nothing. When you get right with God, when you get out of your backslidden state, to turn and to strengthen the brotherhood. I'm going somewhere with this, so stay with me. So Peter seems to be sifted, in a sense, to this state of worthlessness. You been there? I have. Peter denied the Lord. After adamantly stating the fact, I will not deny the Lord. I believe I'm speaking to probably 100% of this crowd that has been converted. You're saved. But I have a hunch there's some in this crowd that need a new conversion. And I'm not talking about salvation again. I'm talking about there are some here, I believe, and as far as I can tell, as of 11 o'clock, 10:55, I try to get everything out of my life right. I want to get it right. But there's some backslidden folks in here. I'm not going to have a testimonial. There's some of you that have fallen prey to neglectfulness of your walk with Jesus. Some of you have fallen prey to the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches. And what I must say today is you are needing a new conversion. It's not a shock to me. Because I've sat in enough chapel services where guest preachers have come. And you know the phrase, Pastor Armacost. The easiest place to backslide is where? Bible college or in a good church or in a good... I've been there. I sat there. Really? I mean, I go to Bible class in the dorm. The guys are encouraging me. We have dorm devotions. I go to Sunday school. I go to Sunday morning. I go to Sunday night. I'm on a bus route and wah, 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 wah. So it's not a surprise to me to note that some of you are in a backslidden state. You need a new conversion. I run across backsliders as I travel. Some are willing to come and talk to me about it and tell me, man, I was backslidden. There are some that still live out in this world, and you know, in your mind, you know, they're backslidden. It's a common thing, sad to say. But praise the Lord, though the Lord's sheep stray, the good shepherd can always find them. Though the Lord's children go into the far country, I'm so glad that there's prodigals that said, I will rise and go to my father. I'm so thankful for that. Not all the prodigals return, but I'm glad there are some. The Lord will find his own. But here's the point I want to challenge you with. Whatever situation you're dealing with, may you be very quickly brought back to this conversion. Speedily, and when you do, strengthen your brethren. As I said, the tendency, though, when you backslide is to hide. Been there. Let me go back. I'd say last 6 months, this is where the Lord's really stirred me because some things have shifted around. I've had my life agitated. Can I say it that way? It's been shifted around, sifted. And I'm just going to be honest with you. I found myself in the pity party pit. I find myself wallowing, Daniel, in the sea of sympathy, hoping for this pastor to come and encourage me. That's not what the text says. The text says when you are converted, not when a brother's converted, when you are converted, your job is to strengthen the brethren. And I sit back and I'm like, I wish they'd come and help me out, and I wish they would come and do this. And I find myself, Levi, hiding myself instead of helping people. And instead of strengthening the brethren, I find myself seeking sympathy. And that's anti what the text is saying. I'm just telling you, this is what I've dealt with. And I've gone back and I'm like, they just don't care and they're just not praying for me. And blah. That's not what's supposed to happen. So what happens is we're backslidden. We find ourselves doing the wrong things. My challenge is pretty simple. Get right, get back on your feet, and start helping people. Now, here's the hard part. It deals with pride. I sat last night with six couples in a honeymooners crew and told them this. I said, this is what I did as a dad. This is what I did. This is why the problems are coming all around. And you know what I tried to do based on this sermon is strengthen the brethren. I said, don't do that. Don't do this. I was an idiot. And on and on. You know what that does? That steps on your pride a little bit. But aren't we supposed to humble ourselves? And so for too long, this is my testimony. For too long, I've sat in this little pit and sucked on my thumb and done the Elijah syndrome and say, oh, it's just good for me to die. It's just time for me to hang up my boots. And I stop and wonder and say, how many young people have I kind of pushed away opportunities to preach and to minister to because I've been sitting in the pit? God's just been smacking me upside the head because it's all about me. I'm not advocating you going into backsliding, but I am saying when you are backsliding, get right, get up, and help somebody. Simon the Strengthener, we'll call him. This has just been helpful for me. I'm, in a sense, revived with this because I had to get out of the pit. So many are sifted. You know what they do? They turn from God. So many are sifted. Watch this. They turn others from God. Peter was sifted, and guess what he did? He left, and then he said, I go a-fishing, and he took, I believe it was seven others with him. That's not the way to deal with things. So many are sifted, and they turn to loneliness. They kind of just slip away, and they're just kind of never heard from again. So many are sifted, and they get bitter. My challenge is if you get sifted, get right, and strengthen the brethren. Peter, no doubt, had to deal with embarrassment and shame. The other disciples, he had stood before them and said, I'm going to stand. Can you imagine this little maid girl coming up to him? You were the one that told me you didn't know the Lord. He had to deal with that. What about the people who he, if I can say it this way, he sided with and said, I don't know him. And he stood, now he's, not long after this, 40, 50 days later, he's up preaching. Can you imagine, they slipped up and said, you were the guy that was cursing. He had to deal with that, but praise the Lord, he got up. He got right. And he says, I've got to do something about this. You think he shocked his brethren when he did this? I mean, here's one of the inner circle. Here's one of the pride and joy of Jesus that when it came time for the test, David, he failed. I mean, I remember being a kid watching people in leadership, and I'd see their kids go bad, and I'd see this go on. I'm like, if they can't do it, I can't. Been there. But that's not for us to worry about. Our job is if somebody fails, obviously we're not supposed to kick them when they're down, but they need to come back and say, don't do this. I'm going to skip down and go over just a couple things that Peter did. If you're a person that's backslidden, and again, I'm not advocating this, just go backslide just because you can experience this, all right? Please don't misunderstand me. But if you're going to help somebody, there's generally some qualifications. What I mean by that is, there could be somebody that comes and says, Brother Ramos, I have cancer. And I can come and I can put my arm around him and say, oh man, I'm praying for you. But you know what's amazing is my mom could come into the same room, same person, and she connects with them. Why? She's gone through it. I've heard talk about it. I've read about things. So here's my thing. I think what Jesus is saying, when you've gone through this and you know how bad it is, tell them, don't do this. Stay away from this. Let me give you just a couple quick thoughts about this. Peter could strengthen the brethren by telling them of the bitterness of denying the master. After Peter denied the Lord, the Bible says Jesus looked at him. We'll hopefully get there in just a second. Jesus looked at him and he went out and what? He wept bitterly. Now, some people can cry at the drop of a hat. You know, you're watching Frosty the Snowman and he melts and you're like, oh! All right, I'm not talking about sweet tears. I'm talking about salty tears, if I can say it that way. There's going to be some bitter tears. I've shed some bitter tears. It's not fun. Peter could tell people, listen, I know what this is like. I've denied the master. He could go to somebody and speak about backsliding because he had done it. So what he would do is say, Don't do it. It'll cost you your life. Don't do it. It's not worth it. That would be something he could tell them. He could also strengthen the brethren by telling them of the weakness of the flesh. What did he say? I won't deny you, Lord. I think Peter had good intentions. Do you think? Do you think Peter thought he was going to tell people, I don't know the Lord? No, he was confident. I can do this. I'll go to prison. And he stood up and he kind of, in a sense, spiritually puffed out his chest and said, I'm with you, Jesus, until the test came. But you know what Peter could do after this? He would come and say, Zach, listen. The flesh is weak. The spirit indeed is willing. But the flesh is weak. I've been there. Don't rely on the flesh. You must be filled with the Spirit of God. He could say that because you know what? He failed. Peter was qualified to talk about this, strengthening the brethren. I like this though. He could strengthen the brethren because he could speak of a personal witness of the power of the Lord's Prayer. I think Peter always remembered this phrase from Jesus, I've prayed for thee. Peter could talk about that. You can remind them. He might say to somebody that's grown cold or presumptuous, he said, the Lord Jesus prayed for me, and it was because of his prayer. Now watch this, that I was preserved from going even further. It could have been much worse. But the prayer of Jesus stopped him at a certain point, and Peter could say, man, it could have been way worse, but Jesus prayed for me. He could talk about it. He was qualified to talk about that. Let me give you the last thought. He could strengthen the brethren because he could speak about the love of Jesus to poor wanderers. There's going to be some young people that you deal with on the bus routes that are going to fade, and you're going to be frustrated about their backslidings. Peter could go to these people and say, hey, let me tell you about when I wandered. What's awesome about this, John, is Peter didn't go looking for Jesus. Jesus came looking for him. When the rooster crowed, the Bible says Jesus turned and looked. Yeah. Peter was the one that went fishing. And who came to the seashore? Yeah. It's interesting when the angel told the disciple or told the ladies, hey, go tell the disciples and Peter. So Peter could say, hey, I got to tell you about this Savior. He loves me. His love is beyond any measurement that there is. Wow, that's a wonderful thing. And what he did in this whole trial, in this backslidden state, he could learn to strengthen the brethren. I have failed. What I'm telling you to do, I have failed in this area. Because of pity party pit. I don't want to go back there. But I can say it's not a good place to be. I don't want you to follow the flesh. I don't want you to wallow in that misery. I don't want you to stay in a backslidden state. And can I say I'm so thankful that Jesus keeps pricking, saying, Eric, I still want you to serve me. Get back at it. Get back at it. Get back at it. And it's just amazing how the last couple of weeks the Lord just revived some things in my heart and how he's stirring up some of these young people. And you know what? I stop and think, how I wish I wouldn't have been wasting these last couple months, because I have. My challenge is you. If you're backslidden, get right and start strengthening the brethren.